Good morning, everyone, and happy Thanksgiving weekend. We are so glad that you guys have joined us here at Joy Church Grants Pass online for service this morning. It's going to be a great Sunday.
Hi, Joy Church. Unfortunately, there's no youth tonight. We normally meet from 6 to 8 p.m. at the youth building on Sundays. Anyone from junior high to high school is invited. To stay updated, follow us on Facebook and Instagram at JoyGPStudents. Can't wait to see you there.
Well, right now we're going to enter into a time of worship. So I just encourage you guys to sing along with us. The words are going to be on your screen. Here we go.
He's coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? 'Cause our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the For the sins of the world, his blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before him. Oh, 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 oh.
Sing, so open up.
So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. 'Cause our God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? 'Cause our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power. Stop. scrape the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Come on, sing that again. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body, oh, began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Victory. Whoa. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Sing out holy one more time.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is none besides you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and
well, what a great time of worship together this morning. Right now, we're going to welcome up Pastor Aaron for the message. Hey, babe. The kids and I were out the other day and we found this very, very special gift. All of us agreed we had to get it for you. So here it is. We really hope you enjoy it.
Oh, babe.
I'm so excited about this. Thank you.
What? Why would you do that?
That's just good advice right there. I don't care who you are or where you come from. If your wife gives you a gift, do not throw it in the fire. That's a good tip. If you guys want more tips like this, there's more where that came from. Just leave a comment in the comment section below. If your wife gives you a gift on Christmas, the appropriate response is that you open that thing up and you smile, a real smile like that, and say, "Wow. Thank you. That is exactly what I wanted." And she does the same for you, probably. Even though we all know, as men, no matter what gift we get for our wife, it's probably going to be wrong. Anyway, great to have you with us. Welcome to Joy Church Grants Pass. We're so happy that you've joined us online. And today we are talking about gifts. We're talking about spiritual gifts. We have arrived at that part in our book study. We've been in a book study called Altogether Separate. We're going through the book of 1 Corinthians. It was written by the Apostle Paul to the church at Corinth. And as most people know who are familiar with the Bible and who have studied these subjects before, Chapters 12, 13, and 14 are the chapters, the go-to key texts when it comes to spiritual gifts. And you might be completely familiar with what the term spiritual gifts means. And you might have no idea whatsoever, but I think overall as an idea, when we start digging into this and looking at some of the different viewpoints and looking at what the different gifts mean and what they are, or at least insofar as we know what they are, I think kind of the overarching idea that's going to kind of guide our discussion here is the fact that the Bible is point blank telling us that God has given each Christian, each person, specific spiritual gifts. And that's not really like a take it or leave it proposition. That's not really like, it's cool, it's a thing, it sounds good, it sounds positive, whatever. I might engage, I might not. I might, you know, accept that gift and put it to use. I might chuck it in the fire. I could go either way, not really sure. Take it or leave it. And we don't really use the take it or leave it approach with other gifts. I mean, can you imagine taking a gift that somebody really, they thought about you, they considered you, they bought you a gift and you just threw it in the garbage. You threw it in the fireplace. Like, what would that tell the person who gave the gift? I mean, what would my wife, Dani, what would she really think of me if she gave me a gift that she thought would be very meaningful and I just immediately discarded it? It would be a slap in the face. It would be a literal slap in the face because she would slap me in the face. She'd probably jump kick me in the throat. And she would deserve to do that because it would be such an offensive thing to do. And I think oftentimes we can forget the fact that the Bible is saying God went out of his way to gift you. He graced you. He gave you something that you didn't deserve, that you didn't earn, but he gave it to you to glorify him, to bring health and healing to the body, the church of Jesus Christ, and to very possibly bring healing and repair to you in your own life. I mean, what could be better than that kind of a gift? And oftentimes I think that we just ignore that fact. We just blow past it for whatever reason. And so as we dive into these scriptures and we look at some of this stuff, a lot of this stuff, there is debate that has been raging for hundreds or thousands of years about whether these gifts are still in operation. There are different sides, and there's a lot of stuff that we don't quite know, and maybe we can't quite know about what Paul was talking about and what this stuff means, but there's also a lot of stuff that we can know, and there's an awful lot of stuff that we can do. And so Paul starts out in chapter 12, verse 1, and he says, "Now concerning spiritual gifts," and it's one Greek word that encapsulates both of these English words, spiritual gifts. It's one Greek word, and it actually doesn't translate specifically as spiritual gifts. It translates essentially as spirituals. Now concerning spiritual things, or it can be translated as spiritual people. But we know as he goes on in the context here, especially in verse 4, that he specifically says gifts. And so typically translators will look at the entire context and look at what all of Paul is saying, or any biblical author is saying, and they'll arrive at a conclusion based on the immediate context. And so this is translated in almost every translation as concerning spiritual gifts. That's what Paul is talking about. He's talking about these supernatural, miraculous gifts that were in function during the first century church. They were happening even at the church in Corinth. And we've talked a whole bunch about what the situation was like in Corinth. There were some weird people who were doing some weird stuff. But nevertheless, Paul says, hey, spiritual gifting, it occurs that there are the supernatural gifts that operate and function within the church, even in spite of the fact that a bunch of you guys are doing very weird things. And so he's bringing instruction. And as far as most scholars know or believe, these chapters are probably about correcting very possibly a misuse of these spiritual gifts as concerned the public gathering, the public assembly, what we would call a church service, a worship service when these Christians were together. Nevertheless, he's bringing correction to some areas, but he's also shedding some light on what spiritual gifting is, what it looks like, and how we should operate, assuming that these are still in practice. So he says, now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers, I do not want you to be uninformed. I don't want you guys to be unaware or ignorant of the position that I have and what's available out there. And so to set the stage just a little bit, there's essentially two camps when it comes to spiritual gifts. There are what are known as the cessationists on one side and the continuationists on the other side. Those are kind of the two poles. And in between, there is nuance and complexities and some differences, but basically those represent the whole spectrum, both poles of the spectrum. The cessationists, the word cessation has the root word cease, and they believed that the gifts, which we're going to unpack in just a few minutes, that the gifts have ceased, that they were meant for this time. In the first century, the beginning of the church, the ministry of the apostles, they had supernatural signs and wonders. They had spiritual gifts that functioned at that time, and it was meant to legitimize their ministry, and it was meant to legitimize their authorship of the New Testament scriptures. And so they believed that that was for them, it was for that time, and it ceased as time went on. And now, since we have completed the canon of scripture, because we have the Bible, we have both Old and New Testaments, now we don't need the gifts to function anymore because we have what they were intended to deliver. That would be the cessationist view. And I'm sure that there are some nuance in there, and you might come from a background, because in the Christian church, there are differences of beliefs based on the gifts and based on practice. And so you might have come from a denomination that was completely cessationist. They would assume, or they would say explicitly, that these gifts, they don't work today. They weren't meant for today. And on the other end of that spectrum, you have what's called the continuationist. The continuationist view is that there isn't enough theological support for the cessationist view, that the gifts they were for then, and they are for today. All of the gifts still function. They're meant to operate in the church today. They're meant to operate through Christian believers in the church. They're for our edification, for building up of the church and strengthening of the church. And the gifts never went away, and they were never meant to. The language that comes out of the next chapter that talks about the gifts ceasing in the future is referring to the culmination of the age, when Jesus Christ comes back, he returns, and he sets things back to how they're supposed to be. That would be our depiction of heaven, that the gifts don't cease until we don't need them anymore, because what the gifts are intended to do has been completed. It's been done by Jesus Christ. And so on one side, you have the gifts passed away. On the other side, the gifts are still here. They're still functioning, and we're meant to dig into them. Now, just in full transparency and full disclosure, I happen to be, and Joy Church Grants Pass as an official position, would embrace the continuationist view, that the gifts are still in operation, that they are meant for today, that we are intended to use them to bring glory to God and to strengthen the church. And does that mean that we expect everything to be weird and wild and people screaming out in tongues and, you know, swinging from the chandeliers? No, that's not what it means. What it means is that theologically, I personally believe, and I want to lead this church into the functioning and the embrace of the spiritual gifts being for today, not so that we can get something or so that we can gain a position, but because I believe this is the kind of power that shows up when the Holy Spirit wants to do something through people. So let's dig into this a little bit. Paul says, I don't want you to be uninformed about this stuff. I want you to know what's going on. So let's answer some of your questions. You know that when you were pagans, meaning non-Jews, you were Gentiles, you were outside of the grace of God, you were led astray to mute idols, however you were led. And I'm just telling you right now, I want to dig into this scripture. I want to talk about this for a long time, and I can't because we are pressed for time today because there's so much content to get through. But I think the idea here is that he's saying, listen, you guys, when you were just out in the world and you were pagans and you were just doing your thing, you assumed that it was a thing that you could go through life and you could engage in sin or whatever, immorality, and it wouldn't really affect you in any way. But however you were led, you actually were led to idolatry. And I think this applies to us today because there's an assumption. We live in a modernistic, a anti-spiritual kind of age right now. And the problem with that is that no matter who you are, what you do, or what you think about yourself, if the Bible is true, you are a spiritual being. You can't get around it. Science can't explain exactly what that means, and it can't explain everything, that there's more to the world than just bare matter and energy. And no matter who you are or what you do, if you ignore this fact, if you just live your life based on whatever feels good or what you might happen to like doing, however you're led, most of the time, or maybe all of the time, you are led into idolatry of some sort. And you know this if you know anything about the nature of addiction, that human beings have impulses towards things that are really not that healthy. And no matter how scientific you get, we can't quite seem to solve that problem. Human beings want to eat too much of the wrong stuff and too little of the right stuff. We want to engage in sexual immorality with too many people and the wrong people. We become addicted to these impulsive behaviors that are horrible for us, and for whatever reason, we are led spiritually to something that we eventually venerate via worship. We idolize, we find ourselves in bondage to something, and it's different for every person, but nevertheless, that is where that road leads. When we just wander, when we just go our own way, when we just follow our impulses, we're led, and we're not just led to something physical, we're led to something very often demonic, something idolatrous, something that holds us in bondage. You know this if you've ever ventured down this road before, where, oh, I'm just going to dabble in this, I'm going to try a little bit of that, and you dabble and dabble and dabble, and eventually you don't even want that behavior anymore, you don't want that thing anymore, but you can't get away from it. It has become your idol, it has become something that you inadvertently have begun to worship, and that's what Paul is saying here. There's a lot of meat on them bones, and I want to keep digging into that, but we can't, we got to get going. It says, therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking in the Spirit of God ever says Jesus is accursed. And this would be like saying Jesus is awful. He's the worst. He's anathema. I mean, this would be like the most offensive thing that you could say about Jesus. And no one can say Jesus is Lord except in the Holy Spirit. And so far as we know, Paul is probably dealing with the fact that tongues were in operation, where people were speaking in languages that they didn't know. Now, this was true, and we're going to unpack that, especially when we get to chapter 14. But it was also true of some of the pagan religions. They would mumble, and they would say things that they didn't understand in some of the pagan rituals. And Paul is probably trying to clear up, saying, hey, you guys might think you're saying something horrible about Jesus, but anyone who's filled with the Spirit of God, even if they're speaking something they don't understand, they're not going to say something that runs against Scripture. They're not going to say something bad or detrimental about Jesus. They're only going to say things that God wants them to say. But moving on, here is where he starts to get into the meat and potatoes of spiritual gifts. In verse 4, he says, now there are varieties of gifts. Varieties. There's different sorts. There's different types. They look different, but the same Spirit. Different gifts, same Spirit. There are varieties of service. There are different ways of serving, of doing something, but the same Lord. There are varieties of activities. There are different functions. There are different ways that the gifts show up, but it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. This is an allusion to the Trinity, the Son, the Spirit, and Father God. This is, he's saying that gifts, there's this altogether separate kind of nature. There's a lot of different functions. There's a lot of different gifts, but they're all empowered by the Holy Spirit. It's not like one gift is coming from one deity and another gift is coming from another one. And to us, that might seem like, well, no duh. But to a pagan culture that was steeped in idolatry, where they had hundreds or thousands of different gods, Paul is saying, listen, we as Christians are altogether separate. Like our unified God, he's given us a variety of gifts, but it's all coming from one source. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. Now, the word manifestation, we don't use that very much anymore, but it means something that is made visible. It means it appears in some way that you can see it, you can know it, it shows up on your radar, it manifests. It goes from being something that's hidden or in theory into practice. It shows up in real life. And it says, to each person is given this manifestation, that the work of the Holy Spirit is not something that just stays in theory land. It's not abstract. It's not, oh, the Lord is doing a work deep inside. It's secret. No one will ever see it. There's truth to that. But as we're going to see, Paul is saying, no, the work of the Holy Spirit as concerns spiritual gifts is that it shows up. It is observable by saved people and unsaved people. It shows up in a way that we can actually see. So to each is given a manifestation of some sort of the Spirit, and it's for the common good. It's intended to build up and edify the church. It is in order to make others better. It's in order to show other people that God is with them, he's for them, he's thinking about them, he has their best interest in mind. For to one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom. We don't use the word utterance very often anymore. Some translations translate this a word of wisdom. And typically this is, first of all, a lot of people try to peg these or pigeonhole these into something that is easier to understand and that we totally get and we can wrap our brain around it. The fact of the matter is we don't totally know what Paul is referring to in each one of these. Now, there's a lot of context, there's a lot of other scripture that show these in practice and in example, and that's great because then we have kind of an idea of what they're about. It's not that we know nothing, it's just that we don't know everything. And so I'll try to give you at least a little nutshell, description in a nutshell of what, as far as we know, they mean. A word of wisdom or an utterance of wisdom would be knowing the right thing to say or do, even though it's not coming from you. It's the Holy Spirit knows the answer to a situation, and somehow you know that. You know what to do in that moment. And I'm telling you, this one can be sound a little abstract, but when it happens to you, when someone does have something from the Holy Spirit that's right, it's amazing because it answers a lot of things and it is completely outside of us. Like, I wouldn't have thought of that. I would not have performed the same behavior just on my own merit, but God was in this and he wanted us to do something specific, a word of wisdom. To another, a word of knowledge. Now, a word of knowledge, what we can see, especially in the life of Jesus and the life of some of the apostles, and even in some very modern day people who function in this gift, so far as we can tell, is it's knowing something about somebody, knowing something about a situation, knowing something from someone's life that you would not be able to know in any other way whatsoever. This has happened at prophetic gatherings. This has happened in one-on-one type of stuff where a person who functions in the word of wisdom or word of knowledge, excuse me, they'll know. They'll say, God's telling me that you did this or were this or saw this or this fact about you. And they've never seen the person, they've never met the person, they don't know anything about them, but God reveals something specific about that person. And I'm just telling you what, I've seen it happen, it's amazing, And it's the kind of thing where it immediately tells you that God sees you, He thinks about you, He cares about you. And someone who drops a word of knowledge on another person, it can do more to change their life than all of the slick messages you could ever put together in your entire life. I mean, God knowing, God caring and saying something through another person is amazing. It's amazing to see. According to the same Spirit, to another faith. Some people just, they have this ability to just believe for amazing things all the time. And I hate these people. They will go out on a limb. They will believe for a lot. They will challenge you. They will put their money and their time and their life on the line because they are so sure that God will come through in some miraculous way. And they always have amazing stories to tell. It makes you super jealous. But then when it comes down to you actually investing your time and money in life, it's like, ooh, I don't know if I want that gift. So to another faith, by the same Spirit. You'll notice that Paul says, by the same Spirit every time, because they all come from the same place. To another, gifts of healing. And we know about this. This is when someone prays and someone is miraculously healed in some way. There are people who are healed from debilitating diseases that medicine can't touch. There are people who are healed of trauma. They're healed of mental illness. They're healed of things that are just like the medical community has run out of answers. And there are more mundane healings than that, but I think we understand what that one means. To another, the working of miracles, supernatural stuff that cannot be explained just by natural means. To another, prophecy. Prophecy is the foretelling or the forthtelling of what God is doing. So foretelling is accurately predicting events that will happen in the future. I've heard of that and seen that before. Forthtelling is just speaking in the place of God, speaking for God to someone else. It's speaking the words of God into another person's life. To another, the ability to distinguish between spirits. This has been called discernment before, to understand what's going on and whether it's demonically influenced or what's happening and why. To another, various kinds of tongues or languages, and we're going to talk about that later. To another, the interpretation of those tongues. All of these, every single one of these gifts, he reiterates, are empowered by one and the same Spirit who apportions to each one individually as he wills. And so that's kind of the driving thrust of this that we opened up with, that God wants to, he chose to, by his Holy Spirit, give spiritual gifts, either gift or gifts, to everyone. That's how he wants his church to function. That's how he wants Christians to interact with each other. He wants his Holy Spirit to be doing something through us that we both wouldn't and couldn't do otherwise. We couldn't do it based on our own strength, on our own knowledge. And as we're going to see in just a moment, sometimes that's uncomfortable. In fact, most of the time, that's uncomfortable. That's why it's a spiritual gift. That's why it is a grace that's been put on our life by God. It's not something that we could manufacture. So moving on, because this is our position that these gifts still function. And don't worry, we'll unpack them more. We'll talk about more what they're supposed to look like, so far as we can tell from Scripture, when they're in a public worship service. But this is the position that we take as a church. But unfortunately, you can embrace this position dogmatically. You can say, yep, that's my theology, I believe that too, and never move on it. Never actually embrace it to the degree that it influences your feet or your mouth, your actions. It's just something that you hold deep inside. Then you have the continuationists who hold their theories deep inside, and you have the cessationists, and both camps maybe argue with each other or disagree with each other's theology, but at the end of the day, they're just kind of arguing about whose ideas are better. I'm not so much interested in that. What I'm interested in is, if we have access to this power, if we have access to these gifts, I just want in. I'm not here to prove people wrong and show how razzle-dazzle I am or anybody else. I just want the Holy Spirit to move. I just want him to do things among us that we could never manufacture. I want the power of God. I want the thoughts of God in our lives, because that's what really changes us. That's what really makes the church his body. And Paul's going to talk about that right now. Verse 12, it says, for just as the body is one, he's talking about the church, the assembly, as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. Well, thank you, Paul. I appreciate that. I came up with this sermon series altogether separate, and Paul just decided to write this so that it would go along with my sermon series. Obviously, we pulled this from this book. Paul is saying you're all individual members. You are all an individual person, but you make up one body. You're altogether separate. He goes on to reiterate this belief. For in one spirit, we were all baptized into one body. In the Spirit of God, we all had one nature, and we were baptized. Our nature was changed. All of a sudden, we went from being separate from the body of Christ to being a part of it, to being an individual member. It says, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, meaning whatever your background was, whoever you were before, you're not that now. All were made to drink from this one spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but many. The body is not just one toe. The body is not one thing. The body has a lot of varied sorts of extremities, different parts. It's not one member, it's many. If the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. Many parts. There's different individuals, there are different people, but they make up one unit, one body of Christ. And this, to me, is what puts the nail into the coffin of this kind of American attitude that Christianity is simply about me and Jesus. And I just go out into nature, or I go out and do my hobby, and I go out by myself, and it's just me and Jesus against the world. And we just retreat into oblivion, and that it doesn't concern any other person, that it's just a wildly individualistic religion. And all that matters is that God saves me, that he protects me and mine. And that's all he's interested in. And I would say that Paul just might jump kick you for saying that. He is saying the exact opposite of that. He's saying Christ has a body. He's incarnated. His presence is incarnated in a physical body on the earth. And it is the church. So if you want to be just this separated body part that's just out on your own and be connected to Jesus at the same time, it does not work. The problem with just you and Jesus retreating out into oblivion with no one else, the problem with that is that Jesus ain't there. You're there by yourself, because the body, Paul says it, it's the body of Christ. It is, that's where Jesus is. He is among and in and with his people, plural. All of you individually together make up the body. And so some people are overjoyed by that. Those of you who are extroverted and you love being around people, you're like, awesome. Those of you who are more introverted, you're like, dang, I'm going to tear that out of my Bible. I don't like that part. But that's what Paul is saying, is that it's not just this one vertical relationship. It's just me and Jesus against the world. It's not that. It's all of us together. We're all together separate. We all together constitute the body of Christ, and that's why the gifts are so important. That's why recognizing the variety of gifting inside the church is so vital. Now, some of this is correction to the Corinthians, because the Corinthians Like he was saying, the eye can't say to the ear and the foot can't say to the hand, I don't need you. There were factions because in Corinth, apart from all their zaniness, apart from how crazy they were, apart from their moral failures and idolatry and horrible stuff that Paul was talking about, apart from that, the gifts were still functioning. Like God wasn't like, yep, you guys aren't good enough. You're not holy enough. I don't know why God has a Southern accent. You know, you guys, you're not allowed to use my gifts because you're sinful. He didn't, for whatever reason, that's not how it worked. And it's probably not how it works now. But they were judging each other. They were forming factions and different groups based on who had what they considered to be better gifts. Oh, well, we speak in tongues and you don't. We're better than you. Oh, we prophesy and we're trying to build this tier system into the church where you know we're at the top because, well, we hear from God and you don't. You have a different gifting. And Paul is saying, woo, that's not how a body works. That you can't just be like, you know what, liver, I'm fed up with you. You know, you don't do anything around here. So why don't you just get out? You're a second rate citizen. Then that's what Paul goes on to say right here. After he says that the body doesn't act that way. Verse 21, it says, the eye can't say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. You cannot get rid of them and still have a body. And on those parts of the body that we think less honorable, we bestow greater honor. And our unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty, which our more presentable parts do not require. But God has so composed the body. He has built the body. He has blueprinted this body to be a certain way, giving greater honor to the part that lacked it, that there may be no division, no factions, no I'm better than you, I deserve more than you, you're in some caste system and you'll never attain the level that I'm at. There's none of that. There's no division in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. And we use this next verse a lot when we're talking about altogether separate. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. That's how the church is supposed to function. And it will only function that way when we perceive ourselves as literally being the body of Christ. The way a body functions, you don't stub your toe and you're like, you dummy. Oh, I can't believe, toe, you are just so, I don't even need you around. No, your whole body suffers. Your soul suffers. Your use of swear words and your children's ears suffer. Everything suffers because it's one unit together. And when we see ourselves that way, when we have compassion on individuals of this body, when we see ourselves as this family, this unit that's unified, then when one member suffers, we feel it. Emotionally, we feel it. We have empathy for others. We recognize what people are going through, and we don't go, man, sucks for them. We say, oh my gosh, there's no way I could let this person suffer and not lift a finger to alleviate their pain. This is not just me versus them. We are part of the same body. He says, now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helping, administrating, and various kinds of tongues. Now, he goes into this kind of second list of gifts, which probably implies that the first list that we read is not exhaustive. In other words, it doesn't list every single gift that there is. In other words, it's representative. It's some of the gifts that are available. And when Paul goes on and he talks about apostles, prophets, teachers, etc., he's probably talking about offices or functions, and we'll get into more of that as we go along. But he's saying, are all of you apostles? Is everyone a teacher? Do you all have tongues? Do you all operate in all the gifts all the time? And the implication here is no. You don't. So don't worry about what the next person has. Don't worry about what the next person is doing. Don't think that the next person is better than you, and don't think that they're worse than you. You have to stay in your lane. You have to be content with who God has made you, with the gifting He's given you. And I would suggest that the chances are good that it's not so much that we spurn the other guy because his gift is so obvious and we think ours is lesser. I would suggest that oftentimes we don't even know what our spiritual gift is. We've never seen it. We've never used it. We'd be overjoyed just to have any of them. And that's what I want to talk about and conclude this whole thing, because I don't think it's just theory against theory, theology against theology, continuationist against cessationist. I think what it boils down to is the humility to say what Paul commands here in the next verse. In the next verses, he says, after he goes through, you know, do you all possess gifts of healing? Do you all speak with tongues? Do you all interpret? Probably not. But listen in verse 31, he says, but, it's disjunctive, but here's what you need to do. Here's what you need to think about. Earnestly desire the higher gifts. There, in verse or chapter 14, he repeats that. He starts the chapter and he says, earnestly desire spiritual gifts. Earnestly. The word earnest, it means jealously, eagerly. It's saying you should want these gifts. It should be normal. It should be the most normal, commonplace, default position for a Christian to just to want the Holy Spirit to do what He's going to do. And I think that most of our problem as humans, and more specifically as Christians, is that it's much easier to bat around theology about a subject, to bat around words and history and different people's thoughts. What's much more difficult is to get into the place where you honestly, truly, eagerly want spiritual gifts. You want something, you desire, you are jonesing, you are begging, because it will show up in your behavior. It will show up in ways that maybe are not commonplace to you. What it probably looks like, in my estimation, is that you hit your knees and you are in prayer and you are crying out that God will send His Holy Spirit, not in a general sense, He will send His Holy Spirit to do something concrete, specific, something that can be seen, something that can be observed. And you'll be asking that He'll do that through you. You'll be asking that God will use your mouth to prophesy to someone. He will use your hands to bring healing or miracles. He'll use your faith to bring people to life through the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that, in my estimation, is the biggest sticking point, is that all of these gifts, to believe that they function is not to believe that God just can do something, because that's easy. The belief that is required here is that He will do something through you. He'll use your mouth to speak words to somebody, and you don't know if those words are right. You don't know if they're true. He'll use you to prophesy. He'll use you to lay your hands on someone and pray for their healing immediately. And almost all of the gifts, you can see their upside. There's amazing benefits that are built into them, but you can also see their downside. Because in almost every case, in all of the spiritual gifts that are listed, if you step out on a limb and you try and you say something or you pray for somebody or whatever, and it doesn't work, it doesn't happen, the person who's left looking like a fool is you and me, us humans, Christians, who are looking for this sort of thing to take place. And that's why I would suggest that the starting place is not just fine-tuning your theology. The starting place is asking yourself, do I not just desire? I'm not just okay with spiritual gifts. The question is, do I want this stuff to show up in my life more than I want anything else? Am I willing to take a leap of faith? Am I willing to step out on a limb? Am I willing to try not so that I can show off or have someone impressed with me, but like Paul said, that the Spirit can be manifest. It can show up for the common good. It can show up so that people's lives can be changed. It can show up and through prophecy or through this encouragement or healing or miracles or whatever it is, other people can see that Jesus Christ still functions in the world today. He still wants to get into your life. That saying yes to Jesus is more than just joining some kind of moral country club, some kind of social gathering, that there's power, that there is that Jesus is still walking among his people, that he wants to do something in your life, but he also wants to do something through your life. He wants to do something through you that the others around you can't do. They don't own that gift. It's that God wants to do something special and unique through you. And if that is you, I could tell you that's me. I've seen some of this stuff. I want to see way more. And I want to see it through my life. I want to be a part of what's going on. I want to see the power of the Holy Spirit do things that we just can't explain. At the end of the day, we could never take credit for. I'd suggest that the place that this starts is you hitting your knees in earnest desire. That you would just say, God, I don't know everything about this, but man, if you will use me, if you will allow me to operate in this way, oh my gosh, I'll do it. I don't mind looking like a fool. In fact, your word promises that I will. I don't mind being persecuted. I don't mind people thinking that I'm weird. I am weird. What I do mind is a life, a Christian life that has a form of godliness but denies its power. We talk about how great it is and how amazing it is, but we never really see you show up. I'm not okay with that, God. I want to see you show up for real. If that's you, I'd suggest that you pray on your own, by yourself and together, and then you have the boldness to step out when you feel like the Holy Spirit is leading you. We're going to talk a lot more about this. We're going to have a lot of practical tips in the future. We're going to create a service that's based around this stuff, maybe in the evening where we can come and engage in this kind of behavior and practice and fail and succeed and really see what God wants to do through us. And we'll definitely let you know as that gets closer. But for any of this to work, the very first thing that needs to happen is that we just need to make Jesus the Lord of our lives. That's the whole message of the gospel. That's what all of this is about. And maybe you've been sitting in church for a long time and you're like, I'm totally fine. I've been in the church for a long time. Well, I'm not sure it totally works that way. I've sat down and watched a lot of golf. I'm still not a professional golfer. Maybe you say, I've never heard any of this stuff, and it's all Greek to me, which literally is written in the Greek language. And the answer for both people, the answer for all of us is the same. It's that we have to bow the knee to Jesus Christ and trust that he really will, by his Spirit, make us new people, that he wants to do something good in our life. He wants to change us and baptize us from being separated from him into a new creation that's part of his body. And if that's you, the way that you do that is to pray, is to speak out loud with your mouth to God, something that you say with your mouth and you believe in your heart. And God hears and God saves and he changes us. If that's you and you don't exactly know what prayer to pray, I'd invite you to repeat after me and pray this one. Dear Jesus, thank you that you care for your children. We've all walked away. We've all sinned. We've all chosen a life that's different than the life that you offer. But Jesus, we repent. We don't want the life we can build. We want real life, your life. And we understand that it only comes through you, through your sacrifice, your blood that was shed on the cross for my sin and my death. Jesus, save me. I'm yours. I believe that you are who you say you are. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
What a great message this morning from Pastor Aaron. We want to thank you guys so much for tuning into church this morning. And just remind you guys, you're going to want to stay updated as we go along with COVID and we try to figure out when we're going to open up watch parties or open up the church. You guys are going to want to stay updated. So follow us on Facebook or visit our website, joygrantspass.com to stay up to date. We also wanted to let you guys know that today is the last Sunday that we're going to be taking up an offering for the Pregnancy Care Center. So you can head to our website, click on Give, and you guys can follow the link there. It says Give to the Pregnancy Care Center today. We give to the Pregnancy Care Center monthly, as most of you guys know. But for the month of November, we want to bless them. We want to go above and beyond, and we want to let you guys have an opportunity to bless them as well. So be sure to head to our website, stay up to date on all of the current information at Joy Church. We're so thankful you guys joined us for service this morning, and have a great Sunday. We'll see you next week.